In August of 2019, I traveled to Ecuador for a week of macro photography. After landing in Quito, we traveled west, the opposite direction of the Amazon basin. Our destination was the cloud forest near Mendo. This cloud forest is a ecosystem unique to the western slopes of the Andes. It's a lush, mossy, verdant area of incredibly high biodiversity. And this is an area I've wanted to visit for a long, long time, ever since seeing pictures from Andreas K. on Flickr years ago. Ecuador is equator in Spanish, and traveling down to a latitude like this, I was kind of worried about getting too hot or being uncomfortable, but it was a really, really wonderful climate to work in, with pretty low temperatures due to the altitude we were at, and almost daily showers and thunderstorms towards the evening. So with such pleasant working conditions, I really try to maximize my time out on the trails looking for things to shoot. And that's one of my favorite things about macro photography, is going slow and listening to the sounds of the forest around you, checking leaves and branches, and using clues from your own environment to, you know, spot signs of life in a new one. I try to pack pretty light on trips like this, and my backpack carries most of my camera equipment. I'm still using a Pentax K3 and a diffused flash. Now, this lens array isn't something I would necessarily recommend. I'm using an old Vivitar 55mm 1:1 macro on a macro focusing teleconverter. This gets me to 2x in a relatively compact form, while still retaining aperture coupling, which is pretty necessary for focusing, and so things aren't super dark through the viewfinder. And despite profusely sweating all over it, this Kakas twin flash has held up pretty well on a few trips now. For diffusion, I'm popping the flash through a few sheets of tracing paper sandwiched in between plastic. And I keep my flash heads pretty dialed back to 1/8 or 1/16th power, so I get a faster recycle time and save on batteries a bit. One of the more commonly seen or noticed bugs on the trip were these cicadellids, or leafhoppers. And as a way to illustrate some of the extreme biodiversity of this area, here's a little compilation of just some of the leafhoppers I saw on this trip. It was overwhelming to see such color and diversity. And this membracid, or tree hopper, was one of the biggest I've ever seen. And I get that they're thorn mimics, but why three horns? Like with the cicadellids, there was quite a bit of diversity in the membracids too. Here's a really handsome banded tree hopper with some eggs. Many treehoppers have a mutualistic relationship with ants. The treehoppers provide honeydew, and in exchange, the ants provide protection. Here, a tiny mite approaches a membracid with a wild pronotal horn. The Hemelytra of tingids, or lace bugs, are highly iridescent, giving off this kind of oil sheen rainbow effect. When I came across this huge coreid on the trail with black and orange markings, I could hardly believe it. It's a beautiful bug. I think it's in the genus Spartocera. All right, let's move on and take a look at some of the beetles I found on this trip. This here is a harlequin beetle, a type of longhorn beetle, and with a body length of about 3 inches, this was easily one of the biggest beetles I've ever seen. And this wasn't the only huge beetle we found on the trip. The scarab was surprisingly strong and really resistant towards being touched. Many beautiful weevils were found as well, including this Compsus species, I think. It's kind of a subtle seafoam green, and it has a metallic peach gold head. Here's a really high magnification stack shot with the Laua 2.5 to 5x lens of a different species of broad-nosed weevil. Many weevils will play dead or curl up their legs and fall right off a leaf if you get too close too fast, but it is possible to shoot them with a careful approach. And again, with active subjects like this, this is where a flash becomes really helpful. This Hadromeropsis species weevil was stomping around as I took photos, and the really short duration of the flash freezes any movement and results in a sharp photo. And I don't know if it's intentional mimicry, but I kept mistaking these funny little weevils for flies when I'd spot them on leaves. This beetle was so metallic I could see my face reflected in it, and I would have preferred to shoot it with natural light, but it's easier to use a flash and a bounce card in this case. Looking like soft red velvet, this handsome fungus beetle was a pretty cooperative subject. I'm not great at identifying beetles in the field, and it wasn't until I got home that I was able to look up that this was an endomycid. To identify a lot of these beetles, I've been browsing through Andreas K's Flickr albums, and that's been super helpful as he shot so much in this Mendo area. And if I can't get a rough ID myself on iNaturalist or hunting around myself for keys online, I've been asking for help on Twitter, and that's been pretty helpful. While out wandering the trails, I found myself almost in a constant state of awe and left with a feeling of overwhelming ignorance. In an area so fertile with such wild speciation and diversity, what animals lie just out of sight? What weird entity would I come across next? I had no idea things like this colorful rove beetle even existed until I came across it wandering about a leaf. Watching it bend its flexible abdomen to pack its wings underneath tiny elytra was like something out of a dream. Despite how active the beetle was, I managed to fire off a few photos before losing it somewhere in the leaves. Thankfully, another even more saturated and briefly cooperative Phanolinus species turned up later during the trip. And the amazing staphylinid discoveries didn't stop here. This metallic electric blue rove beetle was very active, constantly searching about and curling its abdomen. It also kept folding itself up and rolling right off the leaf. Zooming in on the head here reveals this weird pitted texture, with each seta protruding from these chaotically crowded depressions. I'm so macro-focused, sometimes I even debate bringing longer lenses at all while traveling. But I'm glad I did on this trip, as there were so many beautiful hummingbirds around the grounds. I'm using a little Pentax 55-300mm zoom lens, and it's pretty soft wide open, and the autofocus is pretty much worthless, but it can still produce some nice photos in the right conditions, and it's really small and really light given the focal range. I'm very inexperienced photographing birds, and this was one of my first times trying to shoot hummingbirds at all, and it was somewhat dark in the forest, and using a flash wasn't really an option with how far away the birds were, so I found my only recipe for success was cranking up the ISO sensitivity to 1600 or more and firing away in the continuous shooting mode in my Pentax, and then later just cherry picking any successful shots. I must have filled a whole card with just out of focus or poorly framed bird photos. Alright, I'll leave you here, but stay tuned. I'm working on another Ecuador episode with more macro tips and some invertebrates you might have noticed missing from this video, including arachnids, ants, flies, moths, and a rarely seen ancient relative of the arthropods,